better. Hello everyone, thank you for coming. You ever guys bought a car online? Not research, but I've been bought a car online. Imagine going online and designing your car, right? Pick the color that you want, upgrade the leather seats, have a premium sound system, and get a better package because from a whole country. And when you're done designing to your taste or budget, just like anything you buy online, get your credit card out and you pay for it. And when the car is delivered to your home, you will simply sign the agreement on the car's 17-inch screen, which is the touchscreen monitor, and move it. And when you're in the line, when you're ready, and you're ready to go to work, sip in any coffee, and you simply open your phone and set the temperature to a comfortable 68 degrees Fahrenheit or 23.5 degrees Celsius. And then, when you're ready, you walk out of the door, you please summon your car. What does that mean? The car will wake itself up, it will open the garage, pack itself up, close the garage, and wait for you at the curbside. And summon the car, walk to the highway or the freeway, and then you turn on the autopilot. Autopilot, what it means is that the car will actually drive itself. So, steer itself, accelerate, deaccelerate, being aware of the environment around itself, and pretty much hands-free and leg-free. Now you get into the, you come to work, and you get a text message or a notification saying there is a new update for your car, would you like to install it? You're like, sure. And in the evening when you get in your car, you will see the message on your screen saying your update was successful. And we'll actually show you a bunch of new features that we installed, release notes, and how to actually go use the features. And then when you're ready in the evening to basically get out of work and ready to go home, you, oh, actually, before you go home, you're like, okay, I better meet a couple of buddies, you're going for a happy hour. And you stop by the neighborhood bar and you turn your car to the valet. And before you're getting in, remember, oh, this is the update. Which was basically the valet mode, open your smartwatch, open the app, enable the valet mode. So the valet mode does this, it's going to increase or limit the performance. You don't want the valet zipping away with the car. And it also increases privacy. You don't want the valet snooping around in your GPS, looking at where you've been, where you live, where you work. And then, for a couple of drinks, you basically ask your, everybody, dude, how's your new car? Say, you know what, it got faster by 2 seconds earlier in the afternoon through a software update. Everything I just described is one word, which is Tesla, right? And this is real. It actually does it today. And it already exists, right? Not a science fiction movie.
So I was wondering, what is
Tesla got to do with Edward Snowden? Actually, not really. The Tesla is a Google user, by the way. You can go to TeslaMotors.com right now. You can design and buy your car. And it's a Google implementation.
I need a
message. But the point I want to make is that software is the driver of innovation. We talk about ordering the car online on the website. We'll talk about controlling the car through your smartphone or your smartwatch. And the software, the car itself is run by software. Over the year updates, the car gets better with every new update. So we're living in a world of connected devices. So Grab apps, for that matter, even mobile is not enough. So, if you remember a couple of years ago, everybody was talking about mobile-first development. And companies are trying to figure out, you know, what's a mobile-first strategy, how do we go mobile. Charles Tidwell, in his 2000 Bootcamp LA, in doing his talk, basically talks about API-first development. What that means is you want to build your REST platform first, and then build your app or website only using APIs. This, in short, is headless. And if you build your REST platform or backend in Drupal, that's headless Drupal. This is the future of web. What is Drupal's position in this future of web? So increasingly, we're seeing the world of APIs, Internet of Things, new devices popping up every day, consuming, inputting data. Drupal's place in the future is going to look a little bit different than Drupal's place has been in the past. It's going to be more as a hub, a connector, an integrator of all these things. And not as a monolithic group of does it all. Now, monolithic architecture has existed in software for over decades. It's not like Drupal invented it, but Drupal is monolithic. It's deployed as, you know, one big chunk of code. And to scale it, you've got to deploy multiple monoliths. So it is all plucked together in one big application. And nothing wrong with monolithic architecture. It has many advantages. You know, it's kind of generally consistent. It's kind of self-contained. But in contrast to monolith, you have a kind of a new movement going on in the web world, which is kind of much bigger than Drupal, but Drupal is part of it. It's a microservices architecture. Right. So we're talking about the microservices architecture. And this is, what is it? The idea of microservices architecture is you can deliver your application to your customer in a lot of smaller pieces. It can be deployed and be operated independently. It's a lot more elegant, it's a lot more flexible, and it can be scaled much better than a monolith. So, you know, so let's talk a little bit about what some of the advantages are of going headless. You know, we've been talking about headless, and now we're talking about what it is. It provides a lot more flexibility on the front end and using front end resources. It demands a lot of front end kludge, stuff like you can't really write, for example, database queries like you can technically. You don't want to do that, but it lets you do that. And it also makes it a lot more easier to work in bigger teams, when you have an Android team, your iOS teams. Imagine having a Google backend team and as well as having an Angular or a separate front end team as well.
And
it lets you basically extend beyond the web. We're talking about Internet of Things, wearables, smartwatches, TVs, and so on. And it also makes it future proof. We talked about Tesla a little while ago. It has apps in it. And right now the apps are closed, only Tesla closes them, and whenever they have a new app, they will give you an over-the-air update. But they're going to open it up for developers, and hopefully I can't wait for that to happen. And you can actually then build your own apps.
So it's
going headless makes it future-proof as well as to any kind of new platform that can arise. You can easily plug into your existing backend.
And
Drupal itself, we know there are some advantages of obviously of using Drupal itself, which is it comes with security, internationalization, and access control. So Drupal makes headless even more powerful because you're leveraging all what Drupal gives you, not back to Drupal. Of course, there's a large community behind it, and the whole thousands of modules available makes it very easy to support multiple different platforms and capabilities where you can bring in. And then, not only is it, and we were talking about Drupal 8, but you can basically take any Drupal 7 implementation today and make it headless as well. So you have the flexibility to do that. So, by the way, my name is Sam Shetta, and I'm the CTO of Blue Solutions. I've been doing Drupal since 2007, and we've been headless Drupal since 2010. And my colleague, Prateek.
Hello, everyone. Myself, Prateek. I work as an engineering manager at BlueString. And I've been doing mobile application development as well as front-end application development for the last over 5 years now. Yeah. Moving forward, right? Continuing on the story, what Samuel just shared about Tesla, right? Even beyond that, right? I mean, what can you actually do with decoupled CMS? It's not just Drupal, it's decoupled, right? These are different ways you can use any decoupled CMS out there, right? So look at it, right? So one of the ways to generate your static website on top of any CMS, right? The example shown over there is a Nike website, which has a very rich UI experience. It's more of a static website generated out of a tool called Jekyll, which just generates and posts the content out on your of your CMS. And these websites are really useful when you just want to show the static content, which is not going to be modified or edited very frequently. Another way to use decoupled CMS is go hybrid, right? So another example over here is the medium.com, right? Where most of it is content-related pages, but one of the pages which is highly effective is the content editing and adding, right? So those are the only pages where you decouple, the rest of it can easily come with CMS again, right? Another way is you can actually go and build a single-page application as well, right? You can actually build the PS3, PS4, Xbox applications, right, in Angular on top of any decoupled CMS. Another way you use it, it's going native application, building mobile application, right? So a couple of examples over here. So one of the examples is the Tangier app, which lets you, it's a social network for athletes and the teams, right? Where they communicate, they share the drills, the agenda, and then talk about it, right? The other is Yosphere, which is nothing but a Facebook for kids, right? I got a chance to work on a couple of tools, two applications, and these are built on top of headless Drupal 7, right? Another way to use and go decouple is to use a different CMS as a front layer. So imagine you already have a CMS at a Drupal app which serves, which is great at this content management capability, but you still want to use, let's say, WordPress, right? The ConnectU website over here is actually nothing but just the WordPress website, and at the back end is still using the content from Google website. Now think about it, right? I mean, so you already saw static, hybrid, native application, CMS, right? So these are different things you can do and go ahead with any decoupled CMS.
Yeah.
Let's get started with headless Drupal 8, right? With headless Drupal 8, right? I mean, the Drupal 8 specifically makes the API first approach more easier than ever, right? I mean, Drupal 6, they have a lot of modules which are required to go headless. In Drupal 7, they make it a little bit easier by introducing the services module, the JSON and the XML are part of it. With Drupal 8, they have made it a lot easier again. I mean, they have made it like the RESTful web service is actually the part of Drupal 8 code. So all you have to do is go and enable it. The serialization module, which converts your data to JSON or the XML format, is part of the code. Another thing what is there new in Drupal 8 is the HAL, which is nothing but just a convention to have the self-referencing links in your JSON or the XML. So think about it, you are getting a node, right? In traditional terms, you will only get the UID, let's say the author ID as UID 1 or UID 2, right? If you want information about UID 2, you will have to call a different API. What this HAL does is it actually gives you the link of those UIDs, all the self-referencing, all the entity reference in that particular node here itself, and your JSON is self-explanatory. You don't have to tell anyone that this is what the next call will be, right? Apart from it, you need the basic authentication. So obviously, there's a cookie-based authentication as well in Drupal 8, but this is one of the basic modules that you enable. You just can use the basic auth module to do the authentication of your REST APIs, right? So this is one of the apps that we are going to create. We are going to actually go headless with one of the vanilla Drupal instance, create an app out of it, and then, I mean, obviously before it, we will have to expose the REST APIs, and then go and build an app with it. So this is what we are going to do. We are going to the application, which will have an ability to create a to-do, mark it as completed, not completed, listed, edited, deleted, right? So all the CRUD operations that are out there on the content type can be applied on this. So this is what we are going to actually do it. So let's go and then build and go, let's do a headless Drupal. Okay. I hope it's visible at the end. So this is nothing, I mean, just a local installation that I have for a Drupal 8 website. So the first step that we are going to do is, like we talked about the four modules that we saw, right? We are going to go and enable those modules. So we go to the extend. I'll look for all the modules. So the one module is REST Web Services, which is enabled. I've already pre-configured quite a few things. Then there is a serialization, which is already enabled. Then there is a HAL module, and the next is the basic auth integration module. So one of the module which I did not mention earlier is the REST UI module. So there's nothing, it's a contributed module for Drupal 8, but it gives a very good interface to manage your REST resources. And the module is REST UI. Yeah, the REST UI out here. So this will be helpful while managing our REST resources. Next, we are going to do is, we saw the to-do app, right? So let's just go and create the content type. So I'll go to the structure. I already have that content type created for so this is nothing but a simple content type or to-do. If you look at the fields, right? I mean, the title which is already given by default, and I just created another Boolean field called as complete, right? So that's as simple as that. We're just going to have a title which will say a complete task, and the next is there's nothing but the field to figure out whether it's done or not done, right? Now let's just go and actually enable our REST resources. Go to the configuration, right? The link over here, the REST, is what REST UI gives you, right? I mean, if REST UI module wasn't enabled, you have to go and write the code or write the syntax in your YAML files and configure it. You have to actually code your configuration. You have to just write it, enable it. But with this REST UI module, you get this link. I'm going to click on it. So by default, your content resource is already enabled. That means it just goes, go and quickly edit this thing, right? So over here, I mean, by default, any REST API or any content, we can do all the CRUD operations, create, read, update, and delete, right? The first one get out there is actually to get the content or read the content. Second post is to actually create the content. Third delete is to delete the content. And the last pass is to edit or update the content, okay? Over here, the supported formats, as I mentioned, is there's a hard JSON, the self-explanatory JSON, the other two are the normal ones which we are used to. So the JSON and the XML are the other two formats. Okay. So when we're already enabled the hard and the JSON, right? For all the four supported formats, and that's all, right? I'll just go and do the same configuration. So actually, we have gone headless. That's all. I mean, we have actually exposed a content type over the REST API, right? Just go quickly test it. What does it mean, right? I mean, I've just gone headless. What does it mean? I didn't do anything. I just made a few configurations, right? You just go. So there's nothing with this REST API testing client. You could use any other client over there. So this is the Postman which I'm using. I'm actually going to create a to-do a REST API by calling from Postman. But before we do that, right, is one other thing which you need to learn is the CSR token. Or what the CSRF is, which is cross-site request forgery, right? What it does is basically, it makes sure you have to pass a token to all your REST APIs or even to the forms that you submit on your Google Forms so that it makes sure your request is not forged or manipulated by some other source. So to do that, right, I mean, we have to call a get CSRF token API. If you get it right, I mean, this is my domain or the local host of v8.local, and this is the endpoint REST session token. So unfortunately, this is not documented anywhere in Google. It's there on some of the blog pages or the nodes or the issue list, right? But there's nothing like this is documented in the center page where you can get this endpoint, right? So I'm just going to send it, right? Response is 200, okay, and this is the token which I get. Okay, so this is my CSRF token which I'm going to call, use and call all my next API using these. Using this token. So let's just go and create a tool, right? This again my. So we did not. So this is a CSRF token. We did not authenticate it yet. We are going to authenticate it now with all the post requests and the other requests you can get. Yeah, so even anonymous users can get the token. So it's more of a. What Drupal tries to do is tries to validate if the resource or the request. The new post request or the guest request, whoever is making, is the legitimate user. So you get the token, if you have a valid token, right, you will pass it again. If the same token is coming from the same source, you know the request is fine.
Same session.
Yeah, it's kind of a different than that. It's along the session, so even with the forms in the Drupal 8, this comes by default. So whenever the forms you open in Drupal 7 itself, right, the CSRF token comes with it, and when you submit the form, the CSRF token comes goes back with it. So it's there in your HTML or either in the PHP somewhere which sends it back and validates that. So this REST token is actually available to all. I mean, so even there could have been an authentication for CSRF token as well. But what we are going to do is, I mean, currently it's open for everyone. But even the post request is not actually open to everyone. So this is what we are going to see, right? I'm going to authenticate this post request to create a to-do, right? So this is the endpoint, the NTP session node. If you look at the body, right, there's a title which specifies what my value is. It says the bad glossary, I want to put it as my to-do. It specifies the type, the target is to-do. Let's go and do the authorization. Okay, I mean, so this is a post request which is needed authorization. I will just go and do a basic auth. The model which we enabled, you can do a cookie-based authentication as well. So let's say this is a user which I have already get a raw with the password raw. I will just update the request. I'll go and look at the headers. These are the four headers that you would need. The content type I'm going to use the application slash JSON. You can use hard JSON or the XML as well. Same for the accept header, the localization header. This is nothing but just the base64 encoding of your username, colon, password, along with the basic space prefix with it. And the CSR token, I will just copy paste what we, what we just generated. I might have copied the older one. Let me just go back and generate a new one. The CSR token, send it. I'll just copy it again.
And I want to create to do, go to my headers and paste the CSI token. So these are the headers that I need. I'll go and do a, make a send request.
So this is something new, right? We did not got anything in response. With Drupal 7, we used to get the NID of the node that we created. But with Drupal 8, the only thing that I get is the status is just not one created, which tells me my node is created. Let's just go and quickly check out, right? What did I create? I'll go to the content. Yeah. So here's my node. Okay. Now that we have created, right? I mean, let's just quickly create the API which fetches me all the tools as well. What I'm going to do is, and let's see it via views. Okay. I mean, I'm going to expose a view as a REST export, right, which fetches me all the tools. Right, so I will go to the structure, views over here. I'm going to create a view, let's say get to do, right, get new view over here. I'm going to give view name to do. I want to fetch the content of type to do if we create it. And over here, right, in Drupal 7, there was a separate module services underscore views which would be needed to export a view as a REST API, but in Drupal 8 core, this is directly available. So all I need to do is just enable this thing and define my endpoint. What I'm going to do is REST views slash to do slash list. Right, let's say this is the endpoint, you can define any endpoint. Okay. I go, save and add it. What I'm going to do is I'm going to actually expose a couple of fields that we would be needing. So just like in view, right, instead of entity, I'm going to put it as fields, a tab to this display. I want to expose title as title only. Save it. The other fields that I need is the NID, because I might want to do the CRUD operation, which would need me to use the node ID, which is the unique identifier, along with a complete field, right? Once I do that, I have all my fields ready. I want to expose, since the complete is a Boolean field, I want to, let's say, return result in 1 or 0 format, 1 being true and 0 being false. Yeah. Okay, so that's another thing for the ID, that's it. Yeah, so this is what I have done. One thing, another thing which I need to do, if you look at over here, right, this is your sample response, which is coming out of here. The title field has self-referencing links, which I'm going to remove it from the JSON perspective just because I don't need it. I'm going to give my title again. I will remove this link to the content, right? First of all, just like any other view parameter, anyhow you define the view, you can have your contextual filters, define view, pass parameters, and you can all do it in here and expose it as a REST API. Save it, right? So you have actually exposed a view as a REST web service. Now, let's just quickly go and test it, right? So we have our to do, right? So this is the path which we use, REST views to do slash list. The format we are trying to use is the JSON over here. The headers is, I will just copy this again, the same header which we generated. That's it. So you might be wondering why I'm not using any authorization over here. The reason being, the Drupal 8 core has a bug where views are not supporting the basic authentication for a REST export. So there is a patch available out there. If you apply that patch, the basic authentication you can do with views. But I'm not doing over here and keeping it open for everyone, for all the roles out there. But ideally, you would use the authentication header here as well. And hopefully, within the 8.1, Drupal 8.1, that patch will be part of the core as well. Okay. So for now, let's assume, I mean, that's fine. I'll go and send. The response I got is 200. Okay. This is the response I got. So, just by using the JSON, I can use the HAL JSON over here as well and get the HAL form. That's it, right? I mean, so we have actually created all the CRUD APIs. I'm not going to get into this update of the build API over here. We are going to see it in the mobile application that we are going to develop and consume those APIs over there. Right? So, back to these slides, right? So this is what I mean, just a request structure, just a recap of what we just did in the postman, right? You have your content type header, the accept header, the CSI token, which is, by the way, the request structure for creating a to-do, the JSON structure for creating a to-do, the title and the content type that you need to define.
Next is cause, right? I mean, so this is a new term, not even a new term, right? I mean, so it's there. What it means is your browser does not let JavaScript call or make a request to another domain. So if you are on a particular domain, let's say example.com, from the JavaScript of example.com, you want to call or make HTTP request to example2.com, you can't do that. By default, browser will not let you do that because you are calling it from the client side. Think of it, any malicious program can actually use your browser. You might be authenticated on one service, your JavaScript, the JavaScript of the other website you might have opened can actually call. So this is why the cause comes in place. And so Drupal has a way to handle it. You can, or not even Drupal, right? You can handle it anywhere. You can set up the cause configuration at the Apache level or the PHP level to allow your request from the other domain. So you can specify from this particular domain, it's allowed, it's okay to call or make the SDK calls or any HTTP request from that perspective, right? So what I've done is I've just enabled it in the index.php of the Drupal. So some of the code is already there. It just makes it easier. Or it just enables the calls for all the domains. So I can actually make the calls to da.local from any different domain. Now that we have seen it, right? I mean, now we have seen the ingress Drupal, we talked about the different application, different way you can use the decoupled CMS. Let's dive into the mobile application. And when I say mobile, right, you don't just get limited by just your smartwatches in your pocket. Right? It's any other device out there. What we are going to show is obviously a mobile application, but at the same time, the similar application can be developed for any device that can that have a capability to make the HTTP request. So let's learn a little bit about the mobile as well, right? So there will be a lot of misconception about what is native, what is hybrid, what is HTML app, right? So native apps are basically the which has the advanced UI interaction. Maybe the games are the best example to describe the native apps. So whatever games you play on your mobile phones or Android, the native application, they have the fastest performance. For Android, they are either coded in Java. For iOS, they are coded in Objective-C or now recently in the Swift, right? So you can actually you're actually building the application, the native, using the which is supported by the operating system of your phone. The next is the HTML5, right? I mean, there you can actually use a web development skill. So if you know the HTML, CSS, and JavaScript, then it's good enough to develop the application, right? It can be instantly updated, you can access it via browser, put it anywhere on the web server, you can access it on the mobile browser, and it's your web application. The other third one is the hybrid application, where you can still use our web development skill because HTML, CSS, and JavaScript, but at the same time, it lets you use the native capabilities of your phone as well. So things like camera, GPS, accelerometer, anything that you can do, right? You can go and build a hybrid application which has best of both native and the HTML, and the advantage is that it actually supports multiple platforms. You can build a single application that supports the multiple platforms. So one of the frameworks which I'm going to introduce over here is the Ionic framework. It's a hybrid framework. It's an open source SDK which is available to develop the mobile application, the hybrid applications out there. Its performance offsets is unlike any other hybrid application development tool out there, right? Its performance offsets is okay because it has no jQuery, which takes a lot of time. It does minimal DOM operations, so you can have a real-time effect at the best performance. Not as good as the native, but at the same time, as close as to the native. Apart from it, it's based on Angular, okay? So Ionic was built when Angular 1 was out. Now there's a beta version of the Ionic out there, which is based on Angular 2. Okay, so you are actually coding in your JavaScript, HTML, CSS, and you can probably use your web application, which is in Angular, and transform into an Ionic mobile app as well. And it's native focused. So anyone who has done the native Android and iOS development can easily learn it. At the same time, it's built on an analogy where you build it once and deploy it at the multiple platforms. So quickly recapping on how to install it. I mean, so you have these are the prerequisites. You need to have a Node.js. You need to have a Cordova installed. You need to have an Android SDK installed on Mac. You will need the iOS platform on the Xcode. From the Ionic point of view, these are the couple of commands you need to run. So for just Ionic 1, you need to do the npm install -ionic, which will install with the Ionic 1. For the beta version, which is Ionic 2 based on the Ionic 2, you need to just do the Ionic and the beta after npm install. Right? And to start with, right, I mean, there are
multiple boilerplate codes directly available, which you can use and get started. So we are going to use one of them over here to just bootstrap. And the -icon version 2 in here tells INIC that I want to build the app for the INIC 2. And at the same time, you can do it in JavaScript. You can do build application TypeScript as well. So what we are going to do is actually build an application in JavaScript for now. So these are the references. You can see and get the detailed instructions at anicframework.com/getting-started. So on a high level, right? I mean, so this is the INIC project circle, which is this is the main entry point of your INIC app. So just like index.php in your Drupal, there's index.html over here. On line number 16, there's an IN app tag. So this is where your application gets into it. Okay, so this is what your starting point is. And this is where you actually start. So the root component of your app is in app/app.js. So a great app syntax over here defines that this is the root component. You define the template URL. Anyone familiar with Angular might be able to relate it, but this is more like just defining the UI of your root component. Yeah, and just like a small class, the constructor, so currently which is empty in here. So another small thing or something you need to learn is the components. In here, so in INIC, so any reusable UI element is a component. Okay, these are nothing but just the building blocks of your mobile app. Right, they are generally made of your HTML and the CSS, but at times they include the JavaScript as well. Okay, so this is the app that we are going to build. So the four APIs or the five APIs that we exposed, we are actually going to consume and build this mobile application in it. Okay, so let me just go into the case, switch into it. So I've already run that INIC start command. I have that code ready with me. Right. So just ignore these three folders for now, the to-do list, the services folder. Yeah, these two folders actually. The other four folders are with what you get by default in the boilerplate. So there are multiple variations out of there. I mean, you can use and get started with anyone. So when I'm using as a tab, and three pages instead. So let's just, why not just quickly and run it, right? I mean, I just cloned it. And what I need to do is, if I'm trying to run this app in the browser, like you can, since it's an HTML JavaScript, you can still run your mobile app in your browser. I'm going to do an Excel in this folder, so I'm just going to compile my HTML, CSS, the SCSS, or the SAS into the CSS, and generate an app out of it, right? So there's your mobile app, right, in the browser as of now. So there's a root component, you have three tags out there. It feels like native. And here, even though it's a hybrid app, right? Over here in the code, right? I mean, this is where we actually get started. So what we are going to do is actually translate the same app and build the to-do app that we just saw. So I'm going to copy paste a couple of lines of code over here to get started with. And what I'm going to do in here, there's a to-do list. Okay, so I've already created three empty files in here. You can see it's a direct HTML, empty HTML in here. There's a to-do list about JS and this us. So every component, as I said, right, you might have a JavaScript, HTML, and your CSS. So let's just get started with the JavaScript file first. By the way, this could have been the TypeScript file as well, since you can write the INIC app or even the Angular 2 app in the TypeScript as well. What I'm going to do is write this first line. Import page from INIC/INIC. Not the INIC, but INIC framework slash INIC, right? Over here. And then I'm going to tell INIC that this is nothing but just my page. Page, by page I mean it's a screen for me, right? I'm going to remove this for now. This is my template URL. This is where my HTML will get generated. Apart from it, I'm going to create a class for myself, right? This is my class. I will do constructor in here. This is my constructor, empty constructor for now. That's it. I will just define the page. Let's just go and quickly define the HTML for it as well, right? So in the HTML, what I can do is I can actually copy paste some HTML. So what it says that this is one of the tags where I am content. So INIC actually gives you a lot of HTML tags out there. So even the buttons, the formatted buttons, your checkbox, checklist, you can directly use it by just placing the INIC HTML tags.
So in there, what I'm doing is I've just created a section, put in a header and an input box out there. Okay. Now that we have defined your the first component, which is a simple UI which has just nothing, a label or the heading and the input box, right? I'm going to tell Annie that this is my root component. My to-do list is my root component. Okay. I'm going to go to the app.js. Instead of importing the tabs.js, I'm going to import my to-do list in here, right? And I'm going to write the path of it, which tells that I need to import this, and I'm going to say this is my book page in here. Yeah, that's all. So as you can see, right, as I saved it, it actually automatically refreshed my browser version. Should have done that, yeah. There is it, right? So I have my to-do app, the basic to-do app, there's no styling at it because remember our CSS file was empty. So what I'm going to do now, next, is quickly copy-paste some CSS to make it and a little bit beautify it. And so over here, I'm just doing this, one S, yeah. So you can see over here, my SAS got compiled, my CSS got changed. Let's just go and you see it, right? So my to-do app started looking a little bit better now. The next we are going to do is define the rest of the HTML, define the different events on it, and then integrate the APIs to connect with my APIs that I just created. So in the JavaScript file, right, I have, I'm going to copy paste some of the constructor code. Maybe I will just copy paste a few lines of code in here, right? So what I'm doing is, I'm defining my constructor, that this is my, so this is a service which we are going to create just now. And I'm asking it to get the CSR, that's the first API which we called, right? We are going to set the authentication header in here, so and then get the to-do, so different helper functions that I will create in here, right? So let's just go and actually define our services file as well. What I'm going to do is to-do list service.js. Okay, so over here, right, again copy paste some of the code, right? So this is nothing, this is, again over here I'm defining a class, but it's not a component, or it's not a page, because I don't use the @ page directory. So service is nothing, but just like your class, you can define your functions in there, over here, right? So this is nothing, just an injector class from the Angular that would be needed to inject the HTTP into, HTTP objects into my class that will be used in here. The HTTP and the headers are needed to make the HTTP request from Ionic or Angular 2, right? And this is nothing, just a library to map your data from JSON to XML and all, right? So now that I've done this, right? So over here, right? This is my get CSRF function, which does nothing. This got HTTP object gets, and the root UI, what that I've defined over here is, it should be da.local. The user and the password that we just saw in the authorization, and the same UI as slash token, the same way the set authentication header that we have, a function to get the to-dos in here, and the other create to-do, delete to-do functions and all, right, in here. So once I've done it, the last thing that I'm pending is I need to update my HTML to show the actual to-do list, right? What I'm going to do is go over to to-do-list.html, copy some more HTML in here, okay? So, if you're familiar with Angular 2, you might be familiar with the two-way binding concept over here. So over here, I'm using the ng model, the Angular 2, where anything you input, the input box will be translated into this ng model, okay? It's assigned to this ng model, and whenever you update this model, it will get assigned to the input box on the screen, right? Same way, I've just added another section which is doing nothing but just iterating through my to-do object and creating a row for each to-do line item in there. So I've used another HTML directive or a component of an Ionic, which is Ionic checkbox, ion-checkbox. You could use any HTML checkbox as well. So all your HTML would work over here. I've tried to mix it up with some of the Ionic and some of the Angular and some of the normal HTML. So that's it, right? That's all we have done. Okay, so we have some error that we need to resolve. So cannot resolve Ionic slash Ionic, which I did. all I need to do over here is, instead of INEC, I need to use it as INEC framework. Yeah. I think it should compile now, which it did. So now the achievement is changed, I can go in ECL, right?
I cross you, right? The to-do that we created over there.
Let's create another to-do. Okay? Where is? Okay, I remember that. Tables. My to-do is failed. So what happened, I'm clicking on this, it called the services. You can verify it by doing an inspect element. You can make sure and go to your network and see all the attributes. So let's say let's try to mark something is done, which apply me the patch request, which is nothing but just the update request, which is marking a to-do as complete. Okay? Yeah, so you can do all of it, you can edit it and all. So far, we have only developed the application. We have not even seen the mobile version of it, right? And we were talking about the mobile application. What I'm going to do is go into my IDE again. I'm going to stop this and run another command, which is INEC emulate iOS. Oops, sorry. INEC emulate iOS. What it does is it actually generates and compiles your code. Right, it creates a project out of it, a HTML project, if you will, and then translates into an export project, which is understandable by the export, and then triggers export to generate the IPF file, or the which bases the running mobile or simulator. So you can similarly run it on Android phone as well. Over there, to call it. Okay, hang on. Yeah. Okay. And something I know, I'm not sure if I should not move into impression because I'm doing it on local. Yeah, so the idea is, I mean, similarly, it will appear over here, just like it did on the web, right? So you can do all those kind of operations in here on the mobile application. So going back to our presentation, right? That's what you build.
Well, hopefully that was helpful you guys just to get a quick glimpse of how you create your REST platform and then how you actually build a mobile app using Ionic and then actually use your app.
So just in closing, just want to quickly talk about a couple few things. If you remember Dries in his 2011 keynote at Chicago DrupalCon, talked about if you were to start Drupal from scratch today, I would have built it for mobile experience first and desktop experience second. Fast forward 2016, yesterday, in the keynote, he was talking about, you know, going to the fourth industrial revolution, which is a digital revolution. And some of the prominent Drupal community members kind of came together and have recently written a manifesto which kind of defines what some of the core goals are related to that.
So we should not quickly go through what those core goals are.
Is we want Drupal to be the preferred backend content management system for designers and front-end developers. We believe that Drupal's main strength lies in the power and flexibility of its backend. Its primary value to users is its ability to architect and display complex content models. We believe that client-side front-end frameworks are the future of the web. And it is critically important for Drupal to be services-oriented first, not HTML-oriented first, or risk becoming irrelevant. When we think about building a front-end application, you know, what's the first thing, what's the first platform that comes in your mind, right? It's probably Angular, right? React, perhaps, Ember, but you know, Angular is probably the most popular. When you're thinking of building a mobile application, what's the first platform that comes to your mind? It's generally iOS, Android, maybe one of the platforms like Ionic, for example. Imagine if you are a mobile developer or an Angular expert or smartwatch ninja, and you want to build an application and you're looking to use a backend. What's the backend that comes into our mind? It's a rather practical question. It's basically none. That's really that there is no backend that really comes to the mind. Now we know that Drupal is great at modeling data and creating data. So as a community, our goal is to make Drupal that weapon of choice for the emerging front-end development community. What we're going to do is it's going to take us to really exciting markets, new use cases, and enable us to build some really, really awesome applications and solutions. So thank you very much. Thanks for coming. We'll just open up for some questions and answers. If you have any questions related to headless.
So the question is, right, I mean, so whatever data we post by application, where does it go, right? So it's actually in our CMS, right? So the CMS, the Drupal has the database, right? The same database is being used by a mobile application. So it does, it makes an HTTP request, you pass the data via that HTTP request to Drupal, and then Drupal then stores it into the database. So it's the same database.
That means if you go to Drupal, you find that?
Yes, yes. It's a content type. It's a content. So you can basically expose any entity, any content. The other resources that are available, by default in Drupal, are even like taxonomy, your users. You can, so those are directly available to be exposed as a restrict. And you can create a custom APIs as well. You can actually put anything in custom export as a restrict.
The
validation
of the
P2P
network, So
it's like this, right? I mean, you generally have to do it both ends. So Drupal does it by default, I mean, whatever validation you have to find. But generally, you don't want anyone on the mobile to make a complete HTTP request just to find out the validation is failing. Right? Let's say you're entering some VLAN, I really want to validate mobile itself so that HTTP request does not happen. So I really will do it at both the places, but Drupal will do it for sure, whatever you have defined in the back.
Can we maintain any catching system?
Yes, so the rest APIs in Drupal 8 are actually cached.
On the mobile side?
So on the mobile side, you can use any other techniques, right? I mean, so whatever you can, actually your local database as well, if you need to, you can use other caching techniques out there in mobile to get the data. If you are you trying to build asking about the offline applications or any other type of caching? Yeah, so you can do that, yes. So the same to-do app, I mean, it was actually inspired from one of the app out there which was built in Angular 2 and was storing data in your browser itself using local storage. So what we did is we removed the local storage and included the REST API so the data can be stored in the backend.
I used to develop
with OneDev. What's the difference between OneDev and I? So the major difference comes in the way where the performance comes. So as I said, right, I mean, with iMIC, I mean, this is a new framework which I started learning a few months back, right? I was a little bit reluctant to go with a hybrid application to start with. Right? I did raw native application development, but what stands out in iMIC is that it has no jQuery, which generally slows down things. It does minimal DOM manipulation things, which makes it a little bit faster, right? And with Angular 2 and all support, right, which are anyway evolving with the new smartphones out there, which are capable of doing lot more than what other previous smartphones were, right? So it is bridging that gap, and the performance, right, I personally feel the iMIC is better.
Just to be clear, both of them are actually built on top of Cargo One.
So, like, the iOnic application for Apple devices can be made on non-Apple devices?
So the same app which we develop could be run into the Android device as well.
No, my question is for the development. Like, it needs Xcode and the other Apple libraries to emulate and develop an Apple iOS app, but can it be run on non-Apple things like Linux or somewhere else?
So you can run it, but for the final build, you would need a Mac. So basically, just like the browser version which you were seeing, right? You can actually develop the application on Linux or anywhere, right? So once you are done with your application, you just need to do the finalization. You would need Xcode to generate that final build.
So no way out other than that?
Not really, that's what Apple does it.
Then the call has take more time, right? It will be good for us to call many requests in the mouse drag or mouse over.
So are you asking, I mean, is it okay to develop mouse over and other events in mobile application?
Yes.
Yeah, that's fine. So you can use
If lots of content comes, then it affects our performance of the mobile screen.
Right, so that's true for any native application as well, right? I mean, you have to actually wait for the content to come, and then only you can perform operations on it.
Instead of going for Drupal at the back end, why don't we write the back end in a simple PHP and MySQL script?
One other thing, right, which stands out, right? I mean, with views API that we saw, right? In Drupal 7, right, if you were exposing a views as a REST API, right, it would actually run all the theme functions and all the other things that it does with views. Right? But in Drupal 8, it's as good as the native PHP values. It's just hitting the PHP function, querying in the database and fetching the data. It's as good as that. So you are escaping all the other Drupal 8 or Drupal's functionality or theme layer, anything that happens with the views. So it's kind of similar to that.
Is it responsive? Like views output?
So
like
views.
If I have written some kind of views, I want the view output in my mobile. Is it automatically responsive?
So the responsive is generally tied up with the page layout as well, right?
Yes.
So, I mean, that would depend on the theme that you are using in Drupal. So, but that's different than this. You won't need a REST API for the REST API.
Yes. I have a REST call that, for views, kind of for this. And that time, is it a responsive layout automatically or what?
I'm not sure if I... Again, I think it's depending on the theme that you select, and if the theme is responsive, it will be able to do it automatically.
Do you see hybrid apps in future matching native apps? Like a lot of such new technologies are around now, famous like Ionic. Every now and then you'll see a new one. So ever matching of these two native apps and hybrid apps is possible?
Yes, I do, and for a couple of reasons, right? Since you said, I mean, with these improving front-end technologies, AngularJS, React, any other, right? It's taking it up to a new level, right? At the same time, your performance of the devices that you have is increasing day by day, right? Now, like, you have like 4GB phones in your pocket right away, right? So depending on that, yes. At the same time, it also depends on the application that you're trying to build. It won't be a good idea to build, I mean, you can't build a game as a hybrid application. But if there's an app which is more of a content-driven and all, it might be a good idea to build a hybrid application. At the same time, some of the components which require the native interactions, you can still go native party, and that's what the hybrid is, right?
Just to quickly add to that, I think it also depends on the use case that you're trying to solve. Is depending on the use case, it might native will be better, and in some cases, it might be equal.
TypeScript, which I mentioned, right? Which the TypeScript is actually the object-oriented way of writing JavaScript.
JavaScript is really a freely typed language, and Java, Java, C sharp know that you have to define which variable and have what kind of value you have to define. It will be an integer, it will be a string, but in JavaScript it's really open, right? With TypeScript language, you can actually specify that type level. But after that, right, once you wrote it in that manner, your JavaScript HTML is ready. That is packaged as a one single or maybe a multiple HTML pages and given to a web view with a flow.
I think we're out of time. Well, okay, last question, and then if you guys have any more questions, we'll just post the contact information. You guys can reach out to us as well.
Hello. I'm building a website for a book publisher company, and they have a book page. There will have some more filtering system, like 10 or 15 filter. And we solve the problem by views in our front end using Drupal theming. But it will be very easy or hard to build the same filtering system using Ionic?
I'm not really sure if I'm using context.
Like I have I can filter the books by book title, author, publication, education.
Filters and interpretation filters.
Yes.
So any Git API, so anything that is coming out of the view, which is getting data, you can export as a Git API. You can even pass it contextual filters. You can tell it right from this session, just fetch my UID and give me the notes which are written by this particular UID only. You can use the filters, whatever filters are available. So anything in the filter or anything in the view can be exposed as a Git API. Yeah? So I guess we are out of time. If anyone has any question, maybe you can tell them now.
You can be here for a little bit. So. Yeah. Okay, thank you, everyone.